today.
Welcome back to the show, folks. We are done with hour number one. We are in hour number two of two. I know. I wish we had a four-hour show some days. This is definitely one of those days. If you want to be part of the show, call us at 1-800-259-5791. And, of course, I always urge you to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, all those other social media outlets, and go to joshtolley.com if you want to contact us via the Internet. Today we are talking to David Rubin. He is the former mayor of Shiloh, Israel, founder and president of the Shiloh Israel Children's Fund, and author of the book, The Islamic Tsunami, Israel and America in the Age of Obama. He also has a couple other books out there, so if you're going to pick up one, pick up the others, because it gives you perspective and context. Now, when we left off, we were talking about how the presidents, all the way back to George Washington, have been embracing Israel, even though the nation itself at that point hasn't existed for hundreds and hundreds of years. They still knew the promise and the principles behind blessing Israel. There are a lot of people who believe the bad things that happen to us happen coincidentally or not in certain times when we do things against the nation of Israel. So there's definitely something to look into there. Now, Mr. Rubin, in this segment, I would like to talk about the issues that are facing us today, what's happening now, and the tsunami that you say is coming. There is a push in the Muslim world in the Middle East to replace the current governments. In some cases, they've been there 20, 30 years, with new reformers. However, these reformers are proving to be worse off than the people they're evicting. One of the things they're bringing into play is something called Sharia law, and it seems like every nation from Tanzania to Libya to Egypt and soon to be Syria, because the writing's on the wall there, they're all bringing in these people who push Sharia. So what is Sharia, and is it something that the Middle East should embrace, and then should we embrace it also?
Well, Sharia is the Islamic law. It's the law of the land. And one problem that we have, one problem that most people in Western civilization have, is that when we talk about the rule of law, we hear in Libya and Egypt and places like that, they're talking about how these rebels are demanding that there be the rule of law, and people say that's a good thing. Well, in Libya, the transitional government has drafted a constitution already. It's still a draft. There will be changes along the way, I'm sure. But one of the elements that it has in there says that Sharia law, meaning the Islamic law, will be the basis for the law of the land. And then it goes on to say that they support a multi-party system, and they support a country based on the rule of law. Well, if the rule of law is based on Sharia law, it's not based on what Americans know as freedom, where Americans know about freedom of thought, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion, tolerance of those who disagree with you. Those are basic American tenets and basic Western civilization tenets. They are not the tenets of the Islamic world, though. Sharia law says that jihad, holy war, is the highest precept in Islam. And what does holy war mean? Holy war, jihad, means holy war against everyone who is not a Muslim. Anyone who does not agree with Islam, who they call the infidels, and this is all straight from the Quran. This isn't just from the Islamic Tsunami, Israel and America in the Age of Obama by David Rubin. This is straight from their sources, from the Quran, from the Hadith, and these are their religious texts. This is what guides an observant Muslim. And it says in the Quran and the Hadith that in Sharia law that holy war, jihad, is the highest precept in Islam. And according to Sharia law, every non-Muslim is a second-class citizen. It's very clear. And there are a lot of practical ramifications of that, that churches and synagogues cannot be built in countries that are governed by Sharia law. In Saudi Arabia, American soldiers who were stationed there have to hide their Bibles. They're not permitted to publicly be Christians. This is the reality in the Islamic world. This is what the Islamic tsunami is all about. It's about this movement in the Islamic world to have every country, every Islamic country, be governed by Sharia law and to spread it to the West. If you look at Europe, you already see it happening.
Well, a question came up yesterday. We had Jimmy DeYoung on yesterday because I really want to cover the Israeli issue this week. And a caller called in and said that, you know, Israel is kind of the same. I've never been there, so I really don't know. This is an honest question. That Israel is the same, and he was saying that, you know, you can't really be a Christian in Israel and the Bible is forbidden there also. Is there any merit to that, or is that just false?
It's total nonsense. There are churches all over, and of course you can. I mean, Christians, even Muslims, Muslims as well, have total freedom of religion. There are mosques all over Israel. In fact, there's more freedom of religion for Muslims than there is for Jews. I can't go up to the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, the holiest place in Judaism, where the two holy temples stood in times of King David and King Solomon. King Solomon and those who came after. I cannot go up there and say a prayer. If I say a prayer, I will be arrested. If I open a Bible or a prayer book, I will be arrested. On the converse is that when my children go to sleep at night, they're woken up at 4 in the morning. If the windows are left open, they are woken up at 4 in the morning from the call to prayer from the mosques. And it doesn't matter that their call to prayer on these loudspeakers is disturbing people across the valley. It doesn't matter. The Israeli government doesn't do anything about it because they're so hypersensitive to being accused by the world of being anti-religious freedom. So Israel is actually one of the freest places in the world when it comes to freedom of religion.
Well, if that's the case, and I'm glad to hear that it is, why is there such an animosity in the region against a country that is so small? I mean, if there's religious freedom and freedom for multiple different cultures within the borders of Israel, wouldn't that be something that we would see the Palestinians want to replicate, to do themselves? And instead, that's not what we see at all.
Well, you're asking the $64,000 question, because that is a question that has been asked through history, and there have been major studies spent, major studies and major investment in research about why the world hates the Jews. Well, why the world hates Israel? If you look at the Islamic world, well, it comes from the core of Islam. The core of Islam talks about Jews and talks about chasing Jews behind trees and killing them. It says, if you hear the preachers in the mosques speaking on Friday, they say, first we're going to get the Saturday people and then the Sunday people. They make it clear what their intentions are. First we get the Jews and then the Christians and then the infidels. It's very clear that it comes from the core of Islam, that anti-Semitism, and it is so deeply ingrained, and that's why you had these riots in Egypt yesterday, and where they were burning the Israeli flag and raising up swastikas and holding up posters calling to send the Jews to the ovens, like during the Holocaust.
And it's not just the Jewish population that's been threatened in Egypt either. Churches have been bombed and set on fire, and we're going to cover that and how this is coming to our shores here. Stay tuned. You're listening to The Josh Tolley Show. We'll be back right after this.